Welcome back, students. This is the third lecture in the chapter of semiconductors. In this lecture, we are going to study about an important phenomena, a practical phenomena related to semiconductors. It's called the Hall effect phenomena. Okay, there are many experiments based on this. There are many applications of semiconductors based on this phenomena, Hall effect sensors and other applications. We'll be studying that later on. But what is this Hall effect phenomena in a semiconductor? So what is Hall effect? So suppose we have a semiconductor. So let us say we have a thin slice of a semiconductor, and what we do, the semiconductor is carrying current. There is a potential applied over here. There is a potential V which is applied across the semiconductor, because of which there is a current flowing through the semiconductor. So there is a potential applied over here, and there is a current flowing in the semiconductor. Now this current carrying semiconductor, what we are going to do is we are going to apply a magnetic field B in a direction which is perpendicular to the current. So if you see in this figure, the current is flowing towards the right. Okay, it's going in this direction inside the semiconductor, and the magnetic field is applied perpendicular to the plane of the volt. In other words, it's coming out, it's coming outwards. So current is towards the right and the magnetic field is coming outwards. So the current and magnetic field directions are perpendicular to each other. Okay, so what happens then? So when a current carrying semiconductor is placed in a perpendicular magnetic field, what happens is there is a charge which appears across the bottom surface and the top surface of the semiconductor. So bottom surface becomes positively charged, upper surface becomes negatively charged, or it could be other way around also. Bottom surface could be negative, upper surface could be positive, depending upon what type semiconductor it is, whether it's N type or P type. We'll see that in details very soon. So there is a charge which appears, positive negative charge which appears across the top and bottom surface of the semiconductor. So in other words, there is a potential difference. There is a voltage which is generated across the upper and lower surface, and this voltage which is generated is called as Hall voltage. So this phenomena is called as Hall effect, and the voltage which is produced, VH, is called as Hall voltage. So if I take a voltmeter and I connect it across the upper surface and the lower surface of the semiconductor, it will be showing me some reading of voltage, and that voltage is called as the Hall voltage, and it is denoted by VH. So what is Hall effect? When a current carrying semiconductor is placed in a magnetic field perpendicular to the current, a potential difference is developed across the semiconductor, and this phenomenon is called as Hall effect. And the voltage developed is called as Hall voltage. Now, interesting thing to note over here is that what is the direction of that voltage which is developed? The voltage, if you see, plus down and minus up. So voltage direction is voltage, electric field always taken as direction from positive to negative charge, positive to negative. So the voltage is therefore upwards. So it is perpendicular, the voltage which is developed is perpendicular to both current and magnetic field. You see, current was towards the right, magnetic field was outwards, and the current is, the voltage developed is upwards. So it's like this. This is your current, this is your magnetic field out, and this is your current upwards. So they are all perpendicular to each other. Already current and magnetic field were perpendicular, and the voltage, Hall voltage which is developed, is also perpendicular to both of them. So all the three, voltage developed, the current and the magnetic field applied, are all perpendicular to each other. So this is the features of Hall effect. So now, as I told you, this voltage either can be upwards or downwards. Okay, if the upper surface becomes positive and the lower surface becomes negative, the voltage will be downwards. Anyway, it is perpendicular to both current and magnetic field. Whether it's upwards or downwards, in both the cases, it is perpendicular to the current and magnetic field. Now, question is, why does this happen? Why there is a separation of charge? Why there is negative going up there, positive coming down, or positive going up, negative coming down? Why does this happen? And why does it happen differently for a P-type and N-type semiconductor? So that is what we are going to explain in the next part. Explanation of Hall effect. What gives rise to Hall effect? So we are going to have an explanation separate for a P-type semiconductor and an N-type semiconductor. So in this figure here, we have a P-type semiconductor. Now, if you remember, in a P-type, what is a P-type semiconductor? It's a pure semiconductor in which you have doped with trivalent impurities. like gallium, arsenic, okay, trivalent impurities. So what happens when you dope with your trivalent impurities? There is a deficiency of electrons created in it, and deficiency of electrons is nothing but holes. So basically, when you add trivalent impurities to a semiconductor, it produces extra holes in the semiconductor. So in a p-type semiconductor, there are more holes than electrons. How are these extra holes coming from? The extra holes have come because of the impurity, trivalent impurity, which you have added to the semiconductor. So we have this p-type semiconductor. So the majority in this semiconductor are holes. So when you have a current I flowing to this p-type semiconductor, who contributes to this current? Yeah, both of them contribute, electrons as well as holes. But since in the p-type semiconductor, the holes are very, very huge in number, they are majority, electrons are very, very minor in number, we can almost neglect the contribution of electrons to the current in this p-type semiconductor. So we can safely say that in the p-type semiconductor, the current I which is flowing through it is because of movement of holes. And in what direction are the holes moving? The holes are moving from in the direction of the current, because holes are positively charged particles. So holes move in the direction of conventional current I. Now, what have we done to this current carrying semiconductor? We have applied a magnetic field B. In what direction is the field? The field is outwards. So the field is in this figure, the field is represented by this circle with a dot. Okay? What is the meaning of circle with a dot? It represents a quantity which is perpendicular to the plane of the board, to the plane of the paper, and coming outwards. Circle with a dot. Circle with a cross means what? Circle with a cross means something which is perpendicular to the plane of the board and going inwards. So in this case, the magnetic field B is coming out of the board, so it is represented with a circle with a dot in it. Okay, so the magnetic field is outwards. Now, what are holes? Holes are basically charged particles. Okay, now whenever a charged particle moves, so this charged particle, this hole is moving in the applied magnetic field. We have applied a magnetic field over there. So because of this applied magnetic field, the holes will experience a force. Whenever a charge Q moves in a magnetic field B, it experiences a force. That force is called as a Lorentz force. Okay? And the formula for the Lorentz force is F is equal to Q V B sine theta. This is the formula for the Lorentz force acting on the holes which are moving in this inside the semiconductor in the presence of the applied magnetic field. Now let's see what is the value of Q here. Q is the holes, charge of the holes. So holes have a charge equal to plus E, just opposite of electrons. Same as the value of electrons, charge, but positive in sign. Now V is the what? V is the velocity with which the holes are moving. And we have already defined this velocity with which the charge carriers move inside a semiconductor. We have defined this as the drift velocity. So V is nothing but the drift velocity of the holes. B is the applied magnetic field. And theta is the angle between the velocity and the magnetic field, movement of charge and the applied field. Now, the charges of holes are moving in what direction? Holes are moving in this direction, whereas the magnetic field is outwards. So holes are moving towards the right, whereas the magnetic field is coming outwards. So the angle between them is 90. So theta is 90 degrees, sine 90 is 1. So therefore, sine theta is 1. So that is the formula for the Lorentz force acting on this holes. So F is equal to E Vd into B is the value of the force, Lorentz force, magnetic force acting on the holes. Now the question is, what is the direction of this force? How to find the direction of this force? Direction can be obtained, direction of F can be obtained using the Fleming's left hand rule. What is Fleming's left hand rule? It uses the three fingers of the left hand, the thumb, the index finger and the middle finger. What do these three fingers represent there? The thumb represents the direction of force, index finger represents the direction of magnetic field, and the middle finger represents the direction of the current. So it's basically F, B, I. Okay? Now, if you apply this Fleming's left hand rule to this situation over here, so we have the magnetic field B coming out of the board, so it's coming out. The current is towards the right, so I have to put my hand this way. So the magnetic field B is coming out. The current is towards the right. So therefore, what is the direction of force? Therefore, as per the Fleming's left hand rule, the thumb gives me the direction of force, so it is downwards. So according to Fleming's left hand rule, the force is downwards. So force on poles is downwards. So what will happen there? So these holes, as they are moving inside the semiconductor, now because of the magnetic field, because of the magnetic Lorentz force, they will also experience a force in the downward direction, because of which therefore their path changes this way. They start moving towards the lower surface of the semiconductor. Okay, so all the holes start moving towards the lower surface. As a result, what will happen? There will be an accumulation of holes on the lower surface of the semiconductor. So all the holes are drifting downwards. So there is accumulation of holes there, and therefore as a result, in the upper part there will be a deficiency of holes, which is equivalent to negative charge. Holes are positive, so wherever they accumulate, it becomes positive, and wherever they are not there, absent, it attains a negative charge. So lower surface of the semiconductor becomes positive, upper surface becomes negative in case of a p-type semiconductor. So we have understood what gives rise to the Hall effect. So what gives rise to the separation of charge, what gives rise to the voltage generated there? It is nothing but the Lorentz force, F is equal to QVV or EVDV. So this is the basic thing which causes the Hall effect to take place. It's basically the force acting on the holes, Lorentz force acting on the holes or the electrons. Okay. So this is the explanation for Hall effect for a p-type semiconductor. We can have a similar explanation for a n-type semiconductor also. Now for an n-type semiconductor, the majority carriers are electrons. How do we get an n-type semiconductor? We take a pure semiconductor and dope it, add pentavalent impurities to it, valency 5 impurities. Okay. So what happens when you add this pentavalent impurities? There are excess electrons created inside the semiconductor. So when you add a large number of pentavalent impurities, there will be a huge number of additional electrons created inside the semiconductor. So there will be majority electrons in it, and holes will also be there, but a very very few in number, minority carriers we call them. Okay. So in a n-type semiconductor, whenever there is a current I flowing, we can say that this current I is basically because of movement of electrons. There is a contribution from holes also, but that is a negligibly small part, we can neglect it, and we can safely say that the current I which is flowing in the semiconductor is basically because of movement of electrons. Now what we have seen, what we have kept in the previous and this p-type and n-type, we have kept the direction of current and the magnetic field same, so that we can compare the sign of the polarity of the voltage, positive, negative, we can compare it and see whether it is reverse or what it is. So that's why current also is kept in the same direction, so, and magnetic field also is outwards. So we have kept these two things same. So current is flowing in the semiconductor towards the right, but remember, electrons are moving in this direction opposite to the direction of current, because electrons are negatively charged particles, and negatively charged particles move in a direction opposite to the direction of conventional current I. So if current is towards the right, electrons are actually moving towards the left inside this semiconductor. Now again, electrons are charged particles and they are moving in this magnetic field which is applied to the semiconductor, so the electrons will also experience a force. So Lorentz force acting on the electrons again will be F is equal to Q V B sin theta. Q is E minus E, actually it should have been, but we will, for the sake of magnitude only, we are talking about the magnitude over here, so we will keep it as E only then. So charge of the electron is E in value. Vd is the drift velocity of the electrons, which will write it as Vd. V is the drift velocity, B is the magnetic field which you applied, and again theta, what is theta over here? Again holes are moving this way, so holes are moving towards the left, towards the left, and magnetic field is applied outwards, so again theta is 90 degrees. Okay, so sine 90 again is 1. So this is the formula for the Lorentz force acting on the electrons. So if you see the Lorentz force acting on the holes, F is equal to EVdV, and that on the electrons is same in magnitude. Okay, the value is same. What about this direction? What is the direction of F Lorentz force on the electrons this time because it's an n-type semiconductor. Again, using Fleming's left hand rule, F, B, I, okay, force, magnetic field, current. Current is in which direction? Current is again towards the right, okay. Even though electrons are moving towards the left, direction of current is still towards the right, okay. Magnetic field is outwards, so the force is downwards, okay. So force on the electrons, the Lorentz force acting on the electrons is in the downward direction. Direction of force is downwards. So the direction of force, whether it's on electrons or holes, it is the same. Both downwards. This is as per the Fleming's left hand rule. So what will happen to the electrons? Therefore, the electrons are experiencing a downward magnetic force, downward Lorentz force. So the electrons, therefore, as they are moving towards the left, they will now also experience a downward force, and therefore they will start drifting towards the lower side. So as the electrons are drifting to the lower side, they get accumulated on the lower surface of the semiconductor, making the lower surface negatively charged because electrons are negative. And upper surface becomes deficient of electrons and it attains a positive charge. So for an n-type semiconductor, the lower surface is negative and upper surface is positive. Whereas for a p-type semiconductor, it was just the reverse. You can see there. For a p-type, the lower surface was positive and upper surface was negative. So for n-type, it is the reverse. So based on this, based on the polarity of this Hall voltage VH, plus minus or minus plus, there's an important thing which you can find out is whether the semiconductor is n-type or p-type. This is one of the first applications of Hall effect. You can determine the type of semiconductor, because if you take a n-type semiconductor and a p-type, they look exactly the same. So n-type silicon and p-type silicon, they exactly have the same color, feel, texture, everything is the same. There's no way absolutely just by holding it in your hand or looking at it, you can tell whether it's n-type or p-type. So the only way you can determine it is by setting it up in a Hall effect experiment and then check whether the polarity of the voltage is plus minus or minus plus. So based on that polarity of the voltage, you can tell whether the semiconductor is n-type or p-type. So this is about the explanation of Hall effect. So important thing to remember over here is that Hall effect arises. The Hall phenomena is basically a consequence of the Lorentz force acting on the holes in case of a p-type, or Lorentz force acting on electrons in case of a n-type semiconductor. Moving further, we are going to now derive a formula for the Hall voltage VH. Okay, so how much is the voltage which is developed across the top and bottom surface? That's called the Hall voltage. We're going to derive a formula for this Hall voltage. So for this, it's a very simple derivation. Basically, it already covers what we have seen regarding the Lorentz force and thing. Okay, so just a little bit more of it. So we have a semiconductor here. We are going to do this derivation for a p-type. You can do it for an n-type also. So we are considering a p-type semiconductor over here. And so if you remember, for a p-type semiconductor, which side was positive and negative? For a p-type, upper surface is negative, lower surface becomes positive. So that's what we have shown in this figure there. Okay. So p-type semiconductor, it is carrying a current I along the x direction towards the right, same as what we had seen earlier also. Current is towards the right. Only thing in this figure, we have shown it in the form of axis, x-axis, y-axis and the z-axis. So x-axis and y-axis are in the plane of the board, and the z-axis is coming out of the plane of the board. So current is along the x-axis, current I, you can see here, it's towards the right. Magnetic field B is applied in this direction, outwards, along the z-direction. And the voltage, I told you, voltage is always is developed across the third perpendicular direction. So VH is, in this case, it's upwards, plus to minus. So the Hall voltage is upwards, because of which there's a Hall field also, electric field, which is also in the upward direction. Okay, so this is the case of a p-type semiconductor, Hall effect in a p-type semiconductor. So we are going to derive an expression for this VH, okay, Hall voltage. So we know that the Lorentz force acting on the holes, so in the p-type semiconductor it is holes which are existing there. There are a few electrons also which are very negligible in number. So Lorentz force acting on the holes is formula for this, but we'll write it again. F is equal to Lorentz force, also called as the magnetic force, because it arises because of the magnetic field B which is applied. So Lorentz force is also called as magnetic force. I've denoted it as Fm. Okay, so Fm is equal to qvb sine theta. This is the general expression for the Lorentz force, and we have seen it earlier. This is evd into b. Theta is 90 degrees, so sine theta is 1. Q is E and V is Vd, drift velocity. So this is equation number 1. This is the magnetic force acting on the holes. What's the direction of this force? According to Fleming's left hand rule, direction of Fm is downwards. Downwards. So what happens? Because of the downward Lorentz force, the holes are pushed towards the lower surface. As a result, the lower surface becomes positive. We have seen this earlier. Okay. So lower surface becomes positive as a result of the downward Lorentz force. Lower surface becomes positively charged, and the upper surface becomes negatively charged. Upper surface becomes negatively charged. So what happens therefore? There is a potential difference which is created across the up, top and bottom surface of the semiconductor. So there is a potential developed. So this gives rise to a potential difference which is developed, and this potential difference is called as the Hall voltage VH. And that is what we are going to derive a formula for. We are going to derive a formula for VH. So now, what is the direction of VH? VH direction is upwards. Why upwards? Because it's from positive to negative. So Hall voltage is in the upward direction, perpendicular to both current and magnetic field. Now, because of this Hall voltage, because of the voltage VH, there will be an electric field which is also created now in the semiconductor. Remember, earlier there was only magnetic field B acting in the semiconductor. Now, because of this magnetic field, holes started moving down. There was a voltage which was created, and because of this voltage now there will be an electric field. Remember, whenever there is a voltage, there is also an electric field produced. What will be the electric field? So because of the potential difference, there will be an electric field generated in the semiconductor. What will be the value of the electric field? Electric field is represented as EH. It is called as a Hall field. Electric field is called as a Hall field because why? It is arising because of the Hall voltage, VH. So the generated electric field because of the Hall voltage, it is called as a Hall field EH, and the formula for it will be VH divided by, electric field is voltage divided by the distance across which the voltage is generated. Now if you see in this figure, the voltage is generated between the upper surface and the lower surface. Now, how much is the distance between the upper and lower surface? If you see in the figure, it is nothing but W. It is the width of the semiconductor. Length of the semiconductor is L, the width is W, and the thickness of the semiconductor is T. So, in this case, the Hall voltage is developed between the top and bottom surface, where the distance between them is W. So, it is VH divided by W. Okay? So, this is equation number 2. So, let's recollect what we have written over here. Holes experience a Lorentz force. F is equal to EVdB. Direction of this force is downwards. So because it's a downward Lorentz force, the holes start accumulating on the lower surface, making it positive, and upper surface becomes negative. Hall voltage is created because of this separation of charge. Because of the Hall voltage, there is an electric field which is produced, which is given by EH is equal to VH by W. Now, two types of fields are now acting on the semiconductor. Earlier, there was only a magnetic field B which was in this direction outwards, but now there is also an electric field which is acting on the holes. What's the direction of the electric field? Direction of electric field is upwards, same as the direction of voltage. Electric field is from positive to negative. So direction of EH Hall field is upwards. Okay? Now, because of this Hall field, because of the electric field EH, the holes will now also start experiencing an electric force. Earlier they were only experiencing a magnetic force, Lorentz force FM, but now because of the generation of the electric field EH, they will now also start experiencing an electric force, which is, we can write it as FE. So electric force on the poles. Electric force on poles will be FE, will be, what is the, wherever the charge Q is placed in the electric field E, what is the force acting on it? The force acting on it is Q into E. This is the formula for the electric force acting on a charge Q placed in an electric field E. So if we apply to this situation over here, what is the charge which is existing? It's the hole which has a charge equal to E. And how is the electric field which is produced there? Electric field is the Hall field, which is E into EH. So which I can, so this is the electric force acting on the holes. What's the direction of this electric force? What is the direction of this electric force? Direction of electric force FE is upwards. Why upwards? Because the electric field is upwards. Holes are positively charged particles and electric field is upwards. So a hole, because of the electric field which is upwards, the hole will experience an upward electric force on it. So holes are now experiencing two forces. One is the Lorentz force, magnetic force acting downwards, whereas now the holes are also experiencing an electric force FE which is in the upward direction. So there are two conflicting forces, opposing forces which the holes experience. A magnetic force FM which is in the downward direction, whereas an electric force FE which is acting in the upward direction. Now, if both these forces become equal, there is a possibility that they will cancel out each other and then the net force on the holes will become zero. And that is what we say that equilibrium is attained. But the question is, can they become equal? Can the magnitude of FM and the magnitude of FE become equal? Let's look at the values of FM and FE. If you see, the value of FM is E into VD into P. E, VD into P. E is a constant. VD is the drift velocity, which is also a constant, and B is the uniform magnetic field which we have applied across the semiconductor, which also is a constant. So therefore, throughout this setup, throughout the experiment, the value of FM remains the same. It does not change as time progresses. It is always the same, E, VD into B, because all the three things there are constant. But what about FE? FE is E into EH. Okay? Now, E is a constant, no doubt, but EH, remember, is not a constant. When you had just started with the experiment, there was no field. Why? Because there was no voltage. In the beginning, when you started the experiment, there was no separation of charge. The separation of charge occurred only later on when you started the magnetic field and when the hole started moving down. But initially, just when you're starting with the experiment, there was no separation of charge. So that time, no voltage was there, therefore, no Hall voltage was there, and therefore, there was no Hall field also. So to start with, only magnetic force was there, FM, electric force was not there because the electric field was not there. But slowly as the charge got accumulated, this buildup of charge kept on increasing and the voltage kept on increasing and the Hall field also kept on increasing. So what can you say about a Hall field EH? Hall field EH starts from a zero value and it keeps on increasing in value. And therefore as a result, the electric force FE, which is E into EH, will also start from zero value and then keep on increasing. Okay? So it's not a constant. So FM is always the same, whereas FE initially starts from a zero value and keeps on increasing. So if I show it like this, so therefore this is the value of FM. Initially it's always the same, its value always remains the same. FE initially is zero and then it slowly starts increasing in size, in value. And at some point, FM and FE will both become equal in magnitude. As time progresses, as there is more and more accumulation of charge, FE keeps on increasing and at some point it will become equal to FM. And that is the point when FM and FE become equal, they will cancel each other because they are in opposite directions. So, what we can write over here is that FM is constant throughout the experiment, whereas FE starts from zero, starts from zero value increases. So FM is constant, FE increases, and then they both become equal. In equilibrium, both become equal. Equal and cancel each other. So when they cancel each other, the net force on the holes will then become zero. From that point onwards, there will be no more drifting of holes. So whatever holes were down, they will remain down. No more additional holes from top will move towards the bottom surface, and as a result, the voltage, the Hall voltage VH, will become constant. So initially, to start with, Hall voltage was zero. It kept on rising as more and more holes kept down, moving down. And after some time, in equilibrium, when the forces cancel each other, no more extra holes will move down. Whatever are down, they will remain there, no doubt. So the Hall voltage will attain a constant value, VH. Okay. So in equilibrium, therefore, what we can write, FM or FE is equal to FH, FM. Electric force is equal to magnetic force in equilibrium. They both become equal. So what we can therefore write it is that FE is equal to FH, FM. So we'll put the values here. FE was E into EH, and FM was E VD into B. E will cancel out. EH is what? What was EH? EH was the Hall field, if you remember. Hall field, according to equation 2, is VH upon W. So we'll put the value of EH over there. So this is VH upon W is equal to VD into B. We are interested in finding an expression for Hall potential VH. So what is VH from this, therefore? VH is VD into W into B. So this is the formula for the Hall potential VH. But we are not going to stop with this expression, because there is a side problem with this. What is the problem is that in this expression, VD is the drift velocity of the holes. And VD is something which is not easily measurable. There is no experimental way by which you can measure VD. VD is what? The velocity with which the holes are moving in the semiconductor. There is no experimental way you can see the holes moving and measure the velocity. So VD is not an experimentally measurable quantity. So we have to somehow remove VD from here, and instead of VD, we are going to put something which is more easily measurable. Okay. So let us say this is equation number, equation number 4. So my aim now is to remove VD from here and replace it with something else which is measurable, experimentally measurable. So how do we do that? We are going to use this formula for VD. We have a formula for VD as sigma is equal to N E mu. Okay. Sorry, not this expression. We have an expression. J is equal to current density. J is equal to N E V D. Now, from where did I get this expression? This is from the derivation of the conductivity sigma. If you remember, while doing the derivation, we had obtained this formula for J is equal to N E V D. Okay, you can refer to the derivation of conductivity formula, sigma formula. Okay. Also, we have J is defined as one more thing. Instead of N, it will be P over here. Why? Because for a N-type semiconductor, it will be NEVD. For a P-type semiconductor, it will be PEVD. Because in a P-type semiconductor, there are holes. So concentration of holes is P. Okay. Also, J is current upon area of cross section of the semiconductor, which I can write it as current I divided by area of cross section. In this case, current is flowing in this direction. So the area across which the current is flowing is this area. It is this area here. What is the area of that cross section there? It is W into T. So it is WT. Okay. So this is equation number 5. This is equation number 6. equate 5 and 6, and from that I can obtain an expression for VD. So from 5 and 6 I can write that PEVD is equal to I upon WT. Or from this I can further write that VD, I want to obtain a formula for VD because I want to replace VD in this expression, in equation 4, I want to replace VD. So I'm going to obtain a formula for VD based on this equation 5 and 6. So VD will be I upon P E W T. Okay, this is equation number 7. So what I'm going to do now is you substitute the value of VD from equation 7 in equation 4. So this value here VD, this VD over here, I'm going to replace with I upon P E W T. So what will it happen then? So we're going to get a new formula for VH. So substitute equation 7 in 4. Substitute equation 7 in 4. What do we get therefore? VH is VD into WP. So it will become VH is equal to VD was what? VD was I upon PEWT, I upon PEWT into WB. So what cancels from here? W cancels from here. So you get a formula as I B upon P E T. So VH is equal to I B upon P E T. This is a very important formula. Many problems you can solve based on this formula. So this is an expression for Hall voltage. This is equation number 8. Okay. So this is the expression for Hall voltage which we are interested in. Expression for Hall voltage. Now, one important thing we can find out from this formula is that we can find the value of P. P from this will become IB upon VH. You can bring the value of VH down. VH E into T. Remember what is T then? T is the thickness of the semiconductor. You have taken a rectangular piece of semiconductor. The thickness of the semiconductor is T there. Okay? So this is a formula which is practically used to find the concentration of charge carriers inside the semiconductor. P, what is P there? It's a concentration of holes. How many holes are there inside the semiconductor? You can basically calculate using this formula. Now, you cannot do that directly. You cannot count how many holes are there in the semiconductor manually. So the only way by which you can get an estimate of what is the concentration of holes in the semiconductor is by doing this Hall effect experiment and measuring all these quantities I, B, VH, E and T. If you measure them and put them in this formula, you can then calculate the value of P, concentration of holes. Or if it was N-type semiconductor, this would have been N over here. Okay, it would have been N. So you could have calculated the value of concentration of electrons if it was N-type semiconductor. So now, question is, are all these things measurable here? I, B, V, H, E into T, are they all measurable? Let's see. What is I? I is the current which is flowing in the semiconductor. You can always measure it with a current meter. If it's an ammeter, you can measure the current I. B is the magnetic field which you have applied. You either know its value or you can measure it with a Gauss meter. There are ways, there's an instrument called the Gauss meter by which you can measure the magnetic field B. VH is the Hall voltage which is developed across the top and bottom surface of the semiconductor. So if you take a voltmeter and connect it across the top and bottom surface, you can measure the value of Hall voltage VH. So VH is also measurable. E is a constant, has a value 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19. And T is the thickness of the semiconductor. With a weather caliper or with a micrometer screw gauge, you can measure its thickness. So all these quantities on the right hand side of equation 9 are either constants or they can be measured experimentally. Hence, P, the concentration of holes, can be determined. So this is the second application of Hall effect, to determine the concentration of charge carriers inside the semiconductor. What was the first application? First application was to determine whether the semiconductor is N-type or P-type, type of semiconductor. How do we do that? Depending on the polarity. For a p-type, upper side is negative, lower side is positive. For a n-type, upper side will be positive, lower side will be negative. So from that you can find the type of semiconductor. Second application is this, to find the concentration of holes in the semiconductor. Concentration of holes or concentration of electrons if it was a n-type semiconductor. Going further, we defined something else in a semiconductor called as the Hall coefficient, something related to the Hall effect only. What is Hall coefficient RH? Hall coefficient RH is defined as the Hall field EH per unit current density per unit magnetic induction. So that's the definition of Hall coefficient. It is a parameter which is characteristic of a given semiconductor. No two semiconductors can have the same value of RH. Okay, just like density, right? Density is a quantity which changes from material to material. So similar way, Hall coefficient is something which defines a semiconductor. If you know the Hall coefficient, you can tell what semiconductor it is. Okay, so no two semiconductors can have the same value of RH. So Hall coefficient is defined as the Hall field EH per unit current density J per unit magnetic induction B or magnetic field B which is applied across the semiconductor. Now we can put the values of this EH and J there. So we can write this as equal to EH is VH upon W. If you see how we get that formula for VH, VH is here. EH is VH upon W, that's for the equation 2 there. And also J, we can get it from this equation here. Where is that? Here. J is I upon WT. Okay? We are going to use this formula for J in this expression here. So EH is VH upon W and J is I upon WT into B. So we have substituted for EH and J in this expression for RH. And what we get there? W will cancel out because this W comes in the denominator and this W goes in the numerator. So W you can cancel out from there. And what you will get it as? VH into T. This T goes on top. VH into T upon IB. Now further, you can also substitute the value of VH. What is VH? According to equation number 8, VH is IB upon PET. IB upon PET. So we have value of VH we are going to substitute over there. So this becomes equal to IB upon PET into T divided by I into B. So we have substituted the value of VH over here. Okay, this value of VH is IB upon PET. Now what again cancels over there? T cancels out, I cancels out, B also cancels out, and finally you get the value as a very simple expression, 1 upon P into E. So we have RH, Hall coefficient RH is equal to 1 upon P into E. This is equation number 10. So this is expression for Hall coefficient RH. Now, from this Hall coefficient RH, if you know the value of RH, then you can also go reversely and calculate the concentration P. So from this I can find P is equal to 1 upon RH into E. So if the Hall coefficient of a material is known, you can find its concentration of holes or concentration of electrons in the semiconductor, knowing the value of RH. If RH you don't know, then you have to use this formula to find the concentration. Okay, equation number 9 can be used to find the concentration. This is a purely experimental based formula. All the things can be measured from this and you can find the value of P. But as a shortcut, if you know the value of RH of a semiconductor, someone gives you the value of RH, then also you can directly calculate the value of P from this using this expression. Now, the last part is the third application of Hall effect, which is to find mobility. Okay. So how to find mobility of a semiconductor, mu? Again, it's not something which you can directly measure experimentally. But only using the Hall effect experiment, you can find the mobility of electrons mu e or the mobility of holes mu h. So how do we do that? We use the formula for sigma. Conductivity sigma, we have derived this formula for a, what was it? It was n e mu. For a, for in case of electrons, it was sigma e was equal to n e mu e. Okay? Conductivity due to electrons was sigma is equal to n e mu e. Now, what is, we are interested in finding the mobility. We want a value of mobility. So, what is mu e from this? Mu e will be 1 upon this n e, you have to take it down. So, it will become sigma e upon n e. Okay? Now, what is 1 upon n e? 1 upon n e is nothing but R h. You can see from this. Rh was 1 upon P for a p-type semiconductor. For n-type semiconductor, Rh will be 1 upon Ne. Okay? So, Rh is 1 upon Ne. So, for a n-type semiconductor, so 1 upon Ne is nothing but Rh. So, this is your value of mu E. So, mobility of electrons is Rh into sigma E. Similarly, for holes, we can write sigma H is equal to P E mu H. This is the conductivity due to holes. And again, from this we can write mu H is equal to sigma H upon P E. What is 1 upon P? 1 upon P is R H. So, I can write this as R H into sigma E. So, mobility of holes mu H is equal to Rh into sigma e. So this is the formula for conductivity of holes. Now, so this is equation number 12. 12a I'll call it, and this is equation number 12b. Okay, both are equations for mobilities of electrons and holes. Now, if you, for this, if you will see this formula, Rh has to be known. Rh has to be known and sigma also has to be known. Conductivity you can always measure by measuring the current and the resistance across the semiconductor. You can measure the conductivity. But what about Rh? Rh has to be given to you, or if it is not given, you will have to calculate it using this formula. Rh is equal to 1 upon Pe. You will have to calculate it using this formula. But if P also is not known, what you will do? If P also is not known, you have to then calculate the value of P using this formula. Ip upon VHET. So this is a purely experimental formula. So you can, if nothing is known to you, directly you can do the Hall effect experiment. Measure all these things in the right hand side over here. P can be calculated. Then this value of P, you're going to put it over here. Calculate the value of Rh. Then that value of Rh, you're going to use it over here and calculate the value of mu. So you can calculate. So once you calculate P, you can calculate Rh, and then using the value of Rh, you can calculate the value of mu. So this is the third application of Hall effect to calculate the mobility of electrons and holes. So as a summary of all this thing, what are the three applications of Hall effect? The first application, as I already told you, was to determine the type of semiconductor. How can you do that? From the polarity of the Hall voltage, which side, upper side is plus or upper side is plus minus or minus plus, depending on the polarity of the Hall voltage which is developed, you can tell whether the semiconductor is p-type or n-type. So for a p-type, Hall voltage is upwards, meaning what? Lower side is positive, upper side is negative for a p-type. For a n-type, Hall voltage is downwards, meaning what? Upper side is positive, lower side is negative for a n-type. Second application of Hall effect was to determine the concentration of electrons or holes. That is done using these expressions. We already seen this, derived these formulas. P is equal to Ib upon VHET, or for an n-type semiconductor, Ib upon VHET. So you can see where we got these formulas from. It is from this thing here. Here, P is equal to Ib upon VHET. So this is the formula for measurement of concentration. Okay, and the third application is for determining mobility. Mu H is equal to sigma Rh. For a, this should have been sigma E in, sigma H into Rh. And this will be sigma E into Rh, okay? For holes, it is mu H is equal to sigma H into Rh. And for electrons, mobility of electrons, it is mu e is equal to sigma e into rh. We have got it from here. Sigma e into rh, sigma e, this is sigma h, okay, there is a mistake here. This is sigma h. Here also it should have been sigma h. Okay, so that's how we got the expression for mobility. So these are the three applications of Hall effect. This is a very important experiment. We have it in the lab also. Okay, we are going to do it using a virtual setup. We are actually going to perform this experiment and calculate these things, determine the semiconductor, determine its concentration and other things. Okay, so with this, the chapter on semiconductor comes to an end. So this is a very short chapter. There are only three things in this chapter which you have to remember. First thing was the band theory of solids, based on which we classify materials into solid, semiconductors, insulators and conductors. Second part of the chapter was about a drift current, and there was a derivation over there to derive a formula for the conductivity sigma of the charge carriers. The third part of this chapter is the Hall effect experiment, and there's also a derivation there to derive the formula for Hall voltage, and then Hall coefficient and the applications of Hall effect are also there. Okay, so thank you.